My name is Tristan Barrett. I'm an academic radiologist from Adam Brooks Hospital within the University of Cambridge. Topic of today's talk is ensuring quality in the MRI-directed prostate pathway. First, some background. There are four key prospective studies establishing the benefit of MRI before prostate biopsy. Within these, at a negative call, PI-RADS score 1 to 2, there's around a 92% negative predictive value, which allows us to safely avoid biopsy if patients are considered at low risk. At a cutoff of PI-RADS 3, the positive predictive value is around 50%, but this does allow appropriate risk stratification of patients by directing targeted biopsies. Clearly, what we can see there is that the rule out ability is higher than the rule inability, so we still have to do biopsy. We can't avoid biopsy completely. Prostate cancer is a common disease. It's the second commonest male cancer. And thanks in part to these four studies, MRI prior to biopsy is now recommended within international guidelines. However, quality is key for the successful delivery of this MRI-directed pathway. As we say, it's a common disease. In the UK, there are about 120,000 urology clinic referrals with suspected cancer per year. And under current guidelines, the majority of these patients will qualify for an MRI prior to any biopsy. Given that high prevalence, we cannot preserve MR just for larger centres, tertiary referral centres. It has to be performed across the board at the smaller community hospitals. The quality is important at all of the different steps. We can break it down into radiology, and obviously from our purposes, that's the most important aspect. Then the biopsy stage, which in the UK particularly is done by urologists, in some sense it would be radiology, and then the pathology and interpretation by histopathologists. And each of those steps is prone to different issues with quality. I've highlighted some of the areas there. So patient factors, particularly metalwork, motion, image quality, how we set up our MR scanners, different advances in hardware and software, and then the interpretation, which we'll touch on later with the learning curve of how to interpret images. But also urology and pathology have their own issues relating to quality. So how can we establish quality? Well, one of the things to use is the PI-RADS guidelines. This allows us to perform MR to minimum standards and in a standardized manner, and also to interpret them according to the PI-RADS scoring system to hopefully reduce inter-reader variability and to increase the detection of clinically significant cancer, whilst at the same time safely avoiding biopsies in men considered at low risk with PI-RADS score 1 to 2. I've just highlighted some of the different versions of PI-RADS. The current version is version 2.1. Detailed discussion of PI-RADS is beyond the scope of the current talk. But more recently, there has been an emphasis on image quality. PI-RADS version 1, as I mentioned, does give us minimum MR parameters and hopefully ensures a degree of quality. But how do we communicate if the scan is of suboptimal quality? Well, this is how I've done it in the past. This will be my template report. If there's only mild or no artifacts and no effect on image quality, I will not mention it at all in the report. If it's moderate to severe, but not affecting interpretation, I'll mention it within the body of the report itself. And if it's moderate to severe, and I think it's affected my interpretation of the study, I'll then put that also within the conclusion. But it's not necessarily the most standardized way of doing this, and there could be different ways of doing it between different readers. So more recently, the PIPAL guidelines were published. And this is an idea of the scoring system involved. So it's a 1 to 5 scale, 5 being of optimal quality, and it's possible to rule in and rule out all significant lesions. At a score of 1, it's not possible to either rule in or rule out significant lesions. So what we can see from this, in contradistinction to the positive and negative predictive values of PI-RADS, actually the rule in ability is better than the rule out ability. And that sort of makes sense, because if you look at this study here, there's very poor quality on the T2 weighted imaging, significant motion artifact, not possible to see a lesion. But then if we look at the DWI, there's clear marked restricted diffusion in the right mid peripheral zone with matching early enhancements. So despite the poor quality or poorer quality, at least of the T2, it is still possible to rule in a significant lesion given the size of the lesion and the degree of restricted diffusion. Conversely, if there was something more subtle and we didn't see something on the DWI or the DCE, we cannot confidently rule out a lesion. So you can see why the rule in ability is greater than the rule out ability, and that's reflected in the different clinical implications of the scoring system. But how do we know what is good image quality? So if we use an analogy from computer games, this is looking at football or soccer games over the years. So the first one in 1980 looks like this, whereas you fast forward to modern times and this almost looks like a photographic image or video action of a real life game. The same has happened over the years with prostate MRI. So if we go back to the same publication, similar time frame, 1982 at 0.04 Tesla, just about make out the prostate in the center of the image, but we clearly can't get any anatomical detail from it. Fast forward then to 1993, we can better see the prostate. We've got some arrows indicating where a lesion is likely to be, but still nowhere near what we're used to seeing in current times. So we fast forward to recent times, Cambridge 3T scan, no endorectal coil, and really nice anatomical detail around the peripheral zone here with areas of stranding and nodularity within of BPH within the transition zone. So clearly knowing what good quality is and the insight to that is absolutely key, because you know then whether to improve quality if required. An advantage being in a teaching centre is we do see scans from lots of other centres sent in for tumour board review. And also we tend to attend more conferences, so you see other people presenting their work, slides of images, so you know what good quality is and you have a reference point. Whereas if you work in a silo in a smaller centre, you may not be able to appreciate what is good quality because you've never seen anything other than the imaging you yourself produce. So we mentioned PI-RADS and PI-RADS compliance, but PI-RADS compliance alone does not guarantee image quality. And again, it comes back to knowing what is good quality imaging and then being able to have the knowledge to do something about it and to improve image quality. So if we look at this, this was predates PiQOL, but it's a 5-point scoring scale of image quality, and it's pretty analogous to the PiQOL scale. And this study, multi-reader study from NIH that I was involved in, same for T2 and DWI, but I'm showing you the T2 parameters here. So the more compliance with PI-RADS, going up to up to 7 different aspects of the PI-RADS protocol, generally the more compliant you are with PI-RADS, the better the quality of the image is. But we also have these outliers. You have two sites here where they're complying in 7 out of 7 cases of PI-RADS protocol, but they're still producing suboptimal imaging. Whereas you have other outliers here that are only complying with 2 or 4 out of the 7, but are still meeting the threshold for good quality imaging. So why is that the case? Well, the PI-RADS guidelines can at times be quite restrictive, and depending on the age of your magnet and the strength of the magnet, also the coils and the updates with software, you may need to work outside them to produce better quality imaging. So for instance, going to a 3 millimeter slice thickness with zero gap from T2 may not be achievable with older 1.5T scanners, and going to a 3.5 millimeter slice thickness or 4 millimeters may allow you more signal and to overall get better quality imaging. Likewise, increasing the temporal resolution of DCE, in the current version you can go as high as 15 seconds, and then using other ways to optimize your DWI, as we'll see later, for instance, using calculated B values. So these are two examples from the paper, and you can see here a non-adherent protocol, but good quality imaging and clearly able to identify a lesion in the left mid. Conversely, adherent protocol, but very poor SNR within the image, also within the DWI, the T2 and DWI combined, and actually is compliant, one of these cases down here, but is not meeting the threshold for sufficient image quality. However, this is examples from our practice in Cambridge. So even the best, if you like, we like to hope that we are, even the best can fail the test. So why is that? Well, you can see this is probably not our fault. There's a lot of motion, patient motion in this case. There's hip replacement in this case here with artifacts overlying the prostate. So what causes that? Well, we can look at this example here in a video. This is the ideal scenario. There's no rectal loading. There's almost no motion of the prostate here. So you can look at the prostate specifically within this example here, and there's no anterior posterior motion or right left motion. So that's the ideal case with no motion. Conversely, if we look at this case here, this is an extreme example. So we have rectal spasm causing some motion. We also have this bulk patient motion right to left, anterior posterior. This was quite a claustrophobic patient that obviously did not enjoy being within the magnet. And then the other thing we get here is if you look anteriorly, we also get some respiratory motion. Usually that isn't an issue for us with prostate imaging down in the pelvis, But if patients are hyperventilating, you can also get a degree of respiratory motion. So this is an extreme example here with all three types of motion artifacts. So what can we do about that? Well, we can try to do some physical things. So before the study, rectal preparation, there's controversy about this in the literature, but giving suppositories or self-administered enemas to empty the rectum can be beneficial. Simply advising the patient to evacuate the bowels prior to the study can also have an effect. And what is clear is if the rectum is empty, as in this case over here, you will not get rectal spasm and you won't have issues relating to gas and susceptibility artifacts in the DWI. During the study, we give antispasmodics to all patients unless clinically contraindicated. So in our case, that's hyoscine, butyl bromide. In some centers, that might be glucagon. And that can certainly help to reduce spasm, rectal spasm. We've shown that in studies. After the event, you could consider prone imaging if you have air within the rectum, because the air will pass posteriorly, and that will save the diffusion-weighted imaging. I don't have an example of that because that can't really or doesn't really happen in busy practices, because it does involve the radiographer identifying the problem, going into the magnet, getting the patient out, turning them prone, putting the coil back on, putting them back in the magnet, going outside, repeating the localizers. So the whole process may take 10 plus minutes in what is a busy list with very little spare time. So what else could we do aside from that and those physical techniques? We would hope over time, I've showed you this image and this image, and these are some intervening images within the literature over time, that we've clearly improved things from a hardware point of view in terms of the magnet strength, coils, sequences, that we can get to this. So we would hope that that could improve some more and improve our image quality. What other things could we consider? So for T2, radial acquisitions. So we use propeller sequence with GE magnets, there's blade, and multivane with the other vendors. And you can see in this example here, repeating the FIFSE T2 with the propeller sequence, suddenly we get a much clearer image and we can actually see the lesion here in the right mid peripheral zone. Now we keep that as a spare sequence to run within our protocol, so we don't run it as routine, but the radiographers, when they see significant motion artifacts, they will repeat the propeller sequence, hopefully to get a better result. The chances are if you repeat the same sequence, you just get the same result. So hopefully in some cases we improve the images by doing the propeller sequence. I'll touch upon this in the next slide, but these are newer things that are coming through. So AI for deep learning reconstruction, and you can see in this case here, significant motion on the standard acquisition. We repeat with ARDL, so we do a quicker acquisition, which is less prone to the motion artifact, and then we reconstruct the image to get rid of the image noise. Then when it comes to DWI, we have other novel sequences that are starting to be developed. So Muse has been published previously, and you can see this warping artifact due to wear in the rectum has been able to overcome. And then Progress, which is a reverse polarity technique. This is quite common when there's only mild rectal gas. We get this slight warping in the midline with a signal pile up in the peripheral zone. And of course, the majority of tumors occur within the peripheral zone, but that's then smoothed out by applying this DWI technique. So newer things hopefully will come on the horizon. Back to that AI deep learning reconstruction. So this is available with various vendors, Canon, Siemens, GE. We use GE magnets, so we have experience with their sequence of ARDL. And within this, you deliberately acquire a noisy image, and then you use the post-processing technique to denoise it. So what that can do is you can increase the resolution, or you can reduce the time that you scan. You possibly can reduce some artifacts. That's mainly related to truncation artifacts in the spine, not quite so relevant to prostate, but the fact that you can acquire with reduced time means that you will have less effect of motion artifacts. And this is how we use it. This is on 1.5T ARRS. So we deliberately acquire a noisy image to be PI-RADS compliance with a 3mm slice thickness zero gap. But we know that's going to be a noisy image. And then you can apply ARDL, either low, medium, or high. You see, low is not quite enough. Medium gives you a good quality image. And high actually is too much. It oversmooths the image. And particularly in the transition zone, where we're actually looking for a degree of graininess and then loss of graininess with the erased charcoal sign, that can falsely show you pathology. So the medium setting works quite well. So you either save time or you go to a lower slice thickness with no gap, knowing that you get a noisy image, and then you denoise the image after the event. So that's something that I think will come into more and more practice. AI is a hot topic within radiology in general, and this is an area where it's been particularly developed in the post-processing rather than the lesion detection aspect with prostate MR. And what about DWI? So I've mentioned this before, and this is more widely available in the ARDL type techniques. So this is these calculated synthetic B values. So you acquire at the lower B values. Once you get to the higher B values, you can start to hit the noise floor and the imaging becomes less reliable. And that's particularly the case of 1.5T. But you can save time by not needing to acquire the high B value by calculating the lower B values, and it has the advantage of not having noise within the image. So on a pixel by pixel basis, it's plotted out what happens at the lower B values, and you can predict what's happening at the higher B values to calculate this synthetic image. And this is an example here. So you can see on the T2 weight image, yes, it's a wedge-shaped area, but it does have marked restricted diffusion with low ADC. However, on the acquired B1000, you can't definitely say that that's marked change. So overall, you would have to score that as PI-RADS3. However, if you then apply a synthetic B value from that same sequence, you can see now the change is marked, and depending on size and invasive features, it's either a PI-RADS4 or 5. Whereas with the poorer quality image, you're stuck calling that a PI-RADS3. So that's about the hardware and the MR and sequences, but how about us as radiologists? How can we assure quality there? Different terminology may be used. So what's in a name? Well, this is taken from a recent paper that we did. I'll show the reference in a second. The term certification seems more appropriate. The idea for certification is that it's in an individual basis and that it's voluntary. And there are examples of that elsewhere within imaging, so cardiac CT and MR interpretation. And usually these would be put forward by professional medical societies, so the ACR in the USA or the RCR in the UK, or potentially sub-specialist interest groups like ESUR in Europe, or the equivalent in the UK being BSUR, British Society of Urogenital Radiologists. And there are a few articles that have addressed this issue. So this is the AJR expert panel that I mentioned before on the subject of prostate MRI qualification. We have put forward some proposals from the UK on certification. There's also been a recent European consensus statement on MR interpretation and also acquisition, and looking at the concept of radiologist training, but also qualifications. The ACR have prostate MRI designation in place. This is particularly at a center level, but also could be applied at an individual level. And at the moment, this is the only worldwide qualification in prostate MR that's available, which is within Germany. They have two levels of qualification, and they have around 700 radiologists that have met that standard for independent prostate MR reporting. But what are the components of this? So certainly it would be a multifaceted approach. These are some of the key aspects from our UK consensus document. And the thing that people particularly center on is the case number and the reading of cases. This is me from a few years ago with a colleague in urology, Brendan Koo, and one of our urologists, Christoph Kastner, looking at a case. So ideally, you would report these with a more experienced reader to start with. In real life, it's probably in the order of 300 cases that are required to get to the top of the learning curve. One question is, what constitutes a case? Should it be multiparametric MRI? Should it be primary diagnosis? Should it be a mix of cases? But certainly at least 100 to 150, more ideally 300 cases. Another thing is CPD credits, which are related to prostate MR. These could be from conferences, also from workshops. Workshops are another good environment because it allows for networking with colleagues and also allows you to see imaging of different quality, which we've mentioned is quite an important aspect. The other thing is MDT attendance, tumor board meeting, multidisciplinary team attendance, because that puts the interpretation in the context of how patient management is affected. And the crucial aspect really is feedback, and that can come through the MDT process, but comes directly, more directly from the pathology and looking up pathology results of biopsies and or prostatectomy specimens to see both your positive predictive value and your negative predictive value. And of course, the key consideration within any process like this is where to set the bar. You don't want to set the bar too high to make it too much of a hurdle to overcome, where people in busy working practices are not going to do that because we have a need for prostate MR reporters. Conversely, we don't want to set the bar too low because actually that defeats the purpose and could serve to drive the standard down rather than up. And hopefully, with all that in together, you get to you're not in a stage like this where you can quite easily identify the owl here. And this is from a urology colleague. Yes, when you identify the exact series number and image, it might be easier, but you can scroll through the whole data set and you can still identify the somewhat difficult to identify owl in the background of that tree. So that all sounds quite complicated. So could we simplify the process and simply look at patient-related outcomes? So if you remember back to that earlier slide I put, there were the steps from radiology to urology to pathology. So that's the key issue there, that each step depends on the preceding step, but any of the steps can go wrong. So your interpretation is not just seen in isolation. It depends on the image quality. It depends on the biopsy operator, their experience, the quality of the cores that are obtained, and then the pathological interpretation of that. So whilst the patient-level outcomes are very good for retaining histological feedback and mapping out the learning curves and are inherently part of that certification process, simply using them in isolation is not enough. A possible exception to that is the PI-RADS3 calling rate, because we know from previous studies that actually central review from experienced radiologists does reduce the rate of PI-RADS3 calling rate by around 10 to 15%, which is pretty significant. And also that can be image quality related. I showed you that example earlier where actually because of technical reasons, the lesion had to be called as PI-RADS3, whereas in reality it was a PI-RADS4 or 5 lesion. So this may act as a red flag that there's something going wrong somewhere in the system. So either lack of experience in the radiology side or poor quality imaging, and then could warrant further investigation as to why the rates are as high as they are. Certainly if you're towards 30%, that's too high. Ideally, I think we haven't really established that, but ideally, I think you would want it at around 10 to 15% for your overall PI-RADS3 calling rate. So let's go back to this slide that I did here. So let's think about the radiology aspects of patient factors, image quality factors, the interpretation on the data processing. We're usually outlining the targets for whoever's doing the biopsy. So this is relatively linear. And as I've mentioned, each step depends on the one before. So it all comes down to the image quality, because if the image quality is poor, the radiologist's interpretation is poor. If this is poor, then the outlining will not be done correctly. If the biopsy step is incorrect or poorly targeted, then the pathology is going to be incorrect. So although they independently have their own quality issues, they're also dependent on the preceding step. But it's not quite as linear as that, because if we look at this slide here, we've already touched upon the fact that the radiologist's interpretation and the radiologist's experience can affect image quality. And that's the knowledge that there's an insight into the fact that you've got poor quality imaging and the ability to do something about it and to improve image quality. And of course, you can jump steps here because patient factors may affect your interpretation, previous biopsy history, perhaps PSA, perhaps PSA density, particularly if a Leica type system is used rather than PI-RADS. And the patient factors ultimately can affect the decision to biopsy, even if it's a negative MRI. And the image quality in extreme cases can affect the fusion biopsy process. So there's several steps within this. It's multifactorial, and in some cases, it's a two-way process. So what ultimately should we get to? So this is a busy slide, but let's concentrate just on the radiology aspects of it. So I've talked you through the different steps that we have here. So we want to be thinking about QA and QC of the process. Some people use the terms interchangeably, but QA, quality assurance, are things that you put in place to ensure that you meet the optimal standards. And QC, quality control, are things that you do to check that you are actually meeting them. So we've talked about some of the variables that might be in play at a patient level, image quality level, the magnet, and for radiologist interpretation. And these are some of the steps we think about for quality assurance. We talked about this, rectal preparation, antispasmodic agents, some novel techniques to reduce metal artifact or motion artifact. And then when it comes to the image quality, complying with the current version of PI-RADS, also potentially some AI solutions we looked at, and more hopefully will come on the horizon soon. Then when it comes to interpretation, standardized interpretation according to PI-RADS, CME credits, and potentially moving towards certification. Then when it comes to quality control, looking at overall at a patient level, cancer detection rates and compliance with preparation protocols. We've highlighted PyQual for image quality, but there's also vendor-defined QC for the magnet itself and potentially phantom testing. And then for radiologists, highlighting the topic of certification, review in the MDT and participation to see that re-review process. And then we mentioned that perhaps PI-RADS 3 call rate may be something that we could look at in the future. Overall, patient outcomes can be problematic when we're just looking at one component of this multifactorial pathway. So in conclusion, MR is now integral for prostate cancer diagnostics. PI-RADS is established as the gold standard for both image acquisition and for reporting. We've shown that the pathway itself, the MR-directed pathway, is dependent on lots of steps. We can break these down into radiology, urology, and pathology, but all elements rely on experience, the infrastructure that you have, communication between the different disciplines, having a good workflow pattern, and having consistency within this pattern, and also that they're all interdependent on each other. And most typically, each preceding step is particularly dependent on the step immediately before it. And then QA and QC of the whole process, we want to consider that each component and that they're ensure that they're meeting maximum performance levels. For the image acquisition, PyQual is a way, first step in doing this and evaluating it. And when it comes to interpretation, certification is something that has certainly been discussed, and that's also likely to come soon. Okay, thank you for your time.